For this scene in Coco, Pixar's computer kept getting Mama Imelda's skirt caught between her skeleton joints. So Pixar developed a whole new simulation system and digitally wrapped every joint with a layer of invisible fabric. Every single Pixar movie has pushed the boundaries of 3D animation with detailed work like this, from lighting food with two light sources to simulating realistic fur. Let's pick up where we left off in part one, with Merida's realistic-looking locks in Brave. Merida had a lot of hair. If you unwound a strand of it, it would measure 4 feet in length. But the simulation tech hadn't yet tackled the unique physics of curly hair, where each curl has a spring-like structure, but the overall movement of the hair is light and soft in a way that seems to defy gravity. Pixar's first step was to build Merida's hair in layers, each with a different tightness of curl to get that natural-looking variation. The team then spent 3 years developing a special simulator called Taz that'd be powerful enough to handle the 1,500 hand-placed curls on Merida's head. Taz accounted for all the interactions between different strands while making sure that every curl held its shape. The system also changed the effect of gravity on Merida's hair, using a gravity coefficient closer to the one on the moon than the one on Earth. With a lower gravity, the hair could keep its mass, but flow and bounce in a natural way. To give the hair its softness, the lighting team used a mix of subsurface scattering and colored shadows to imitate the complex way curly hair scatters and transmits light. It took 2 months just to nail the hair in this scene, when Merida pulls back her hood to reveal the full volume of curls. But that work set the stage for Pixar to represent all hair textures on screen in the future. In Cars, Pixar used ray tracing in small doses to create reflections and shadows in dynamic scenes with lots of shiny vehicles. But for the vast majority of shots, Pixar's artists still built reflections and mapped out shadows by hand. That changed with Monsters University. The lighting team wanted more time to focus on the artistic rather than the engineering side of lighting, like creating new scare lights for scary monster scenes. To streamline the process, the goal was to ray trace pretty much everything. All the shadows and light refractions, even the reflections in a character's eye. This required an overhaul of the lighting system the studio had used since the first Toy Story. Pixar built a new system called Global Illumination that modeled the natural distribution of light in a scene, all based on real-world physics. Now, every time an artist placed a light source in a shot, the computer would know how that light would travel and interact with other elements, and it would simulate the resulting bright spots, shadows, and reflections. Global Illumination became the default lighting system for every Pixar movie, making Pixar's light more closely resemble the kind we see in real life. But this model didn't account for more fantastical scenarios, like we'd see in Inside Out. Joy, the main character of Inside Out, is supposed to resemble a star. She's made up of glowing particles that radiate off her skin. This character had to shed warm, yellow-blue light wherever she appeared in a scene. And the light had to track with her bouncy movement, which wasn't easy since she's literally a ball of energy. So Pixar's RenderMan team came up with an effect they called geometric area lights, or geolight. This tool allowed lighting artists to select a character model and turn it into a mobile light source. That way, Joy's light could travel with her. If she walks up to a prop, she projects her glow on it. And she casts light onto other characters too, like this pivotal scene with Sadness. Her light was also accurate to her body structure. For example, when she picks something up, we see the light emanate through her fingers. This made the outward glow look more believable, taking Pixar's lighting system yet another step forward. Nature plays a bigger role in The Good Dinosaur than in any other Pixar film. So the filmmakers really needed to nail the landscape of the American Northwest. They were especially focused on the huge, constantly changing clouds they observed on a research trip. Traditionally, Pixar movies used matte-painted clouds, meaning the artist would paint clouds onto background plates. But The Good Dinosaur took place entirely outside, with clouds in almost every scene. So they decided for the first time to create entirely volumetric clouds. That meant these clouds were 3D objects animators could move around, like a character or a key set piece. But unlike a character or set, a volumetric object has no defined surface. It's just made up of billions of tiny particles. The clouds team built a huge library of what they called cloud Lego parts. They joined these volumetric forms together to create huge clouds of every type: rain clouds, stratus clouds, and cumulus clouds. With the clouds actually in the scene, viewers can move in and around the 3D forms as the camera moves, making this world that much more immersive. Hank from Finding Dory was probably the hardest thing Pixar had ever animated at that point, according to Michael Stocker, a supervising animator on the film. He definitely wouldn't have been possible in Finding Nemo. Most four- or two-legged characters, like humans, have joints and defined limits to their movement, but octopi don't have skeletons or any clear structure to how they move. To capture that extreme flexibility, Pixar had to rethink its whole approach to character construction. This started with Hank's rig, the basic puppet that animators use to control the character's movement. While humans have clearly defined elbows that bend, Hank's elbow had to travel down the length of his tentacle. So Pixar's engineers developed a special rig that used a cylinder as Hank's elbow and relied on a special curve function to dictate how that muscle should move. This let animators stay faithful to that key rolling motion of octopus tentacles. The filmmakers also needed the webbing between Hank's tentacles to flatten and spread out with each movement. So the character team created a new control to set the depth of the webbing. This helped give Hank the squishy, squashy motion that you see here, and it allowed Pixar to give life to its most complex character to date. The filmmakers behind the third Cars movie wanted to emphasize the aging details on hero characters, like the older racer Louise Nash. Any car's surface is composed of multiple layers: metal flake paint with a clear coating, car stickers, dirt, grime, and mud composited on top. But traditionally, when Pixar showed an object with detailed texture from a more distant shot, all the little details would merge into a single pixel, making the object's surface look too smooth. So Pixar developed a technology called bump roughness mapping, which converts what looks like bumps up close into surface roughness in farther away shots. Louise, for example, keeps the texture of her clear coat scratches even in medium and wide shots. And this tech wasn't only applicable to cars. Pixar could use the bump roughness method to preserve details in all kinds of 3D objects, as we'll see for Incredibles 2. Clothing simulation was always going to be a big undertaking in Coco. The movie demanded more cloth than any other Pixar feature, and many scenes would involve a lot of movement. On top of this, the characters weren't just humans, but skeletons. Bones have all these crevices where clothes can bunch up and collide with each other, creating too many collisions for Pixar's simulator Phys T to handle. So the studio spent 3 years creating a new continuous collision detection program, which helped the computer automatically resolve issues like cloth bunching up around a skeleton's hand or snagging on a bony knee. Animators also digitally wrapped the skeleton's joints with super stretchy invisible material, so that when the bones separated, the pants would touch that invisible barrier and not fall into the gaps. This was a creative solution to a unique problem, but it laid the groundwork for even more advanced cloth simulation later on. Fashion was also a big part of The Incredibles, but in the first movie, the characters' suits weren't actual clothing. They were patterns shaded onto the characters' bodies, which is why in some shots, the fabric behaves more like skin, and The Incredibles logo stretches out in unrealistic ways. For the second movie, the filmmakers wanted their clothing to work better with the extreme movements of characters like Elastigirl. That began with constructing actual digital garments that sat on top of the character's skin, like normal clothing. The next key step was manipulating UV coordinates on the clothes. In Incredibles 2, a tech called 3D UV scaling preserved the details of the cloth when stretched or compressed. Pixar also found a way to use bump roughness mapping, the technology from Cars 3, to keep very fine illuminated details intact, even when Elastigirl extended her body to wild proportions. That made it possible for Elastigirl to get a brand new suit, this iridescent unitard that keeps its subtle shimmery texture through all the hyperflexible movements. Compare that to this shot of Elastigirl stretching out in the first Incredibles. The surface of her new suit looks much more like actual fabric. You can see how Pixar has stretched the limits of what its cloth technology can do. The fourth Toy Story brought up issues of scale, thanks to all the scenes set in the antique store, and thus all the toys. There were over 10,000 antiques in this store, and Pixar had to find a way to program each and every one with varying levels of wear and tear. Animators tackled this challenge by assigning 3 different ages to the antiques: fairly new, moderately aged, and extremely aged. The computer then gave the items surface details that fit those ages, from micro scratches on china platters to wear and tear on old rugs. The ability to add detail to so many different objects is what gave the world of Toy Story 4 its visual complexity and appeal. Pixar has had its share of unique characters, but Dad from Onward is made up of only a pair of legs. The rest of his body is just stuffing, with a sweatshirt, vest, and gloves thrown over it, which made it difficult to animate. Dad's legs could be rigged and animated like a traditional character, using reference footage filmed in front of a green screen. But his upper half had no skin or structure underneath it, so it called for simulation, not animation, in many shots. The arms, for example, just had to flop around, a movement that's more believable when simulated. So the filmmakers developed a hybrid simulation-animation rig for Dad. With this rig, animators could manipulate Dad's lower half like they usually would, but the simulation team controlled everything above the belt when needed. The movement of Dad's stuffing was based on a volumetric sim, a simulation for something with volume, while the clothes on top of the stuffing were largely controlled with standard cloth simulation. Pixar also improved the interaction between volumetric sims and cloth sims, so that if you pushed on Dad's clothing, the stuffing would get squished believably, and vice versa. If you pushed on the stuffing, the clothing would move out of the way. The hybrid rig improved the relationship between separate simulations, and ultimately it showed how simulation and animation could join forces to create realistic movement on an unrealistic character. Pixar needed to make its musician characters play instruments, most notably Joe, who had to go through the complicated, rapid motions of playing the piano. At first, the team tried to use simulation to handle the interactions between Joe's fingers and the keys, relying on a collision system like the one used for the cloth in Coco. But the collision system didn't work because Joe's fingers were too heavy for the computer's piano keys. So instead of simulating the movement, character technical director Jason Davies developed what he called a finger contact rig. When one of Joe's fingers pushed down on a key, the rig would calculate the correct angle for the key to rotate, so it looked like Joe was pushing it. The modeling and rigging teams also gave Joe's hand 292 controls, including variables they'd never used before, even adding a control for each tendon to convey the tension in Joe's hand as he played. This level of hand and wrist control made his performances look passionate and convincing on screen, with a level of realism that pushed the boundaries of human movement in animation. Luca is a coming-of-age story about a sea monster who can transform into a human, and the filmmakers needed to show this transformation in a fluid way. They also wanted to give animators the power to dictate all the details of that change, such as where the transformation begins and the speed at which it happens. Before, adjustments to those kinds of details would have to go through animation, then go to the effects team, and only then would animators get to see how it all looked after rendering. But for Luca, they created a transformation rig, so animators could fine-tune the different aspects of the change one by one and see the result right there in front of them. That way, they could perfectly time the transition, from the layers of changes in the human skin to the flipping scales and octopus spots in the sea monster skin. This was a new way to streamline the whole production process and put more artistic control in the hands of animators. After all, Pixar views technology first and foremost as a storytelling tool. Whether creating a new kind of light to better convey a character's emotions, or rethinking cloud models to give audiences a stronger sense of place, Pixar's technical innovations have always served its stories first. And that's the key to the studio's record of creating both groundbreaking innovations and beloved movies.